So for the people who don't know, let's go ahead and have you introduce yourself and tell us who you play from. Let's start from the end here, and we'll come closer to me, and so everyone's here on the same page.
Are we starting with me?
Hi,
yes, sir.
I'm J. Michael Tatum, and I play Tenya Ida.
Hi, I'm Dustin Briner, and I play Izuku Midoriya.
Hi, I'm Emily Neves, and I play Aerie.
I'm Tia Ballard, and I play Ragdoll.
I'm Felicia Angel, and I play Toru the Gawkeray.
All right. Come on in. Come on, have a seat. Why do you guys think that My Hero, what's it about that resonated with everybody? Why is it so popular? What's that spark? What do you think you bring that spark to this show that all these fans love?
Oh my gosh.
You get those deep questions in the morning.
Well,
is that coffee?
Not enough. I don't know. There's so many kind of variables that they just happen to get right, I think. It's very telling that the narrative quality is very strong. I don't know if y'all know this, but we're kind of in the middle of like superhero mania right now. There's a lot of like those kind of movies coming out. I don't know if you've seen them. It's sort of a indie operation. And it's just clever in the way that it presents sort of concepts and superpowers that we're familiar with, but subverts them in kind of cool, fun ways. And now there's just a lot of it to love, so that helps too.
I also think it has a lot of heart.
Yeah.
It's brimming with heart and humor, and I think that goes a long way.
I think, for me personally, I think one of the strengths of the show is how, for me, it's about found family. It's about how all these people kind of find their power within this group dynamic that kind of lets them, kind of teaches them who they are and what they can contribute. And I love that. I think the show does it so well because all these characters kind of make sense as a team. Which I think it's beautiful. But that's my favorite part of the show, is like the family aspect of it.
So, for each of you, what was the audition process like for the show? I mean, you see the gig, or you get a call, or your agent gets in touch with you about it, and you're like, did you have an idea of who you were going to be voicing, or was like, it's just kind of a, like, we, you know, here just, it's a general kind of like, free-for-all.
I think when the auditions went out, so we get what are called audition sides, which are like little books or emails with like prints of the characters on there, and here's lines, and there's like a little description, and you're encouraged to try out for like, here's three or four characters, give us a pass on who you think you'd be strong for. And I don't know about you guys, but when Colleen, the show's director, and line producer, she was like, here's this, and you can read for anybody, but definitely read for Ida. But anything you want, but definitely Ida. And it was really funny because I was like, oh, cool. I really didn't know about the show. I kind of keep myself very blissfully unaware of what's going on and what's cool because I am not cool. And I like to keep it that way. And I was actually traveling. I was in a hotel when the auditions were due, and so I literally auditioned for Ida in a little pillow fort that I built out of what I had in the hotel room, and I was like, this is garbage, I'm not going to get this, and then I got it, and then it's, yeah. So, Colleen is a genius at casting character, because she'll be like, you're basically this character. This is you. It's just you as an anime character. And yeah, at least that's my experience.
No, same, and thankfully it's always been a compliment, because you get nervous sometimes when you're like, oh, this is going to be a reflection of your perception of me.
We'll be recording lines, and like especially in the early days when Ida was very, very, when they were really playing up how he was the sort of human sheepdog, kind of keeping everybody in line, and his gestures and his tone of, you know, he's just in the Japanese, everything. I would be previewing it, and then I would hear Colleen laughing in my headphones, because she's out there like just doing the laughing, when she kind of holds her face like this, and she's like laughing, and I'm like, what? She's like, I've seen you do that exact thing. In public. I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm nothing like Ida.
Go ahead.
Yeah. Oh no. It was just very similarly. I audition in person, and we do read for multiple things, which I think is kind of the lead here that a lot of folks don't know about the process, is that you're very rarely just targeted for just this one thing. You get the opportunity to show a range. So there were many several folks to choose from, and I think we all probably read for as many as were plausible, and then it's the casting director's job to fit us into the ensemble in a not necessarily always about, like, yes or no to you specifically for this specific character. There are tons of other factors at play, just based on how everything else is cast. To the symphony.
My experience auditioning very specifically was actually, it was the, excuse me, the rare thing that you're talking about. Because I don't think that I auditioned for the initial round of, you know, like class 1A, like the first round of auditions. I was doing a lot of theater and I couldn't do it. But I did audition a couple seasons later and didn't get anything then. And then specifically for Aerie, when she was, you know, showing up, Colleen, I think, picked maybe like 5 or 6 of us, and I only auditioned for Aerie in that round. And it's interesting, I was actually working full-time in the office at Funimation, when we were still in the old building, and it's embarrassing, but it was the morning, I was due, and I was like, oh my gosh, I've got to do this, I'm just going to go into an empty studio that's not being used and audition on my phone, and I'm just going to do it that way. So I looked at the schedule and I found an empty studio and I went in and the director and the engineer were in there and I was like, hey, do you guys mind if I just pop in here and just record an audition on my phone just in the quiet really quickly? And the director was like, why don't we just record it for you? And I was like, seriously? He's like, yeah, whatever, man. And so, yeah, I recorded it in studio and submitted it that day, and then I was the last person to turn in my audition. And Colleen came by my office later that day and she was like, I was like, oh my god, I freaked out. And then it was like 4 months before I could tell anybody about it. So.
Now see, Emily, in my movie, Emily, you go into that studio to do the audition. I'm like, let's record for you. You do it. And then Colleen appears behind a curtain. She's like, you got it. She's the one. We weren't even
thinking record. That's what I'm telling people from now on. She pulls off the mask. She's the director the whole time. Full disclosure, was Cliff Jacobs.
You know, I'm trying to, like, I may resonate toward this one character, but you don't get it, but you get this one, and you go like, oh, well, this turns out to be the best.
I'm always surprised when I get one.
Yeah, it's like, they just keep letting me in the building, and I don't understand why.
Yeah.
Proven myself to be a menace. I don't.
Yeah. Do you guys find sometimes if you'll audition for something, be like, there's no way in hell I'm getting this. I just know that I'm just throwing my head because it would be rude not to because they've asked and whatever, and then you get it and you're like, oh god, they've made a horrible mistake.
Now I have to do the thing.
That was me when I got my first commercial gig. Even going into the studio to record it, I was like, what if they saw the wrong name? Like, they want me. I'm going to show up, and I'm not the one they listen to. Because commercials are new to me. But, yeah, it always feels like this is going to be an accident. What a silly thing to do.
I'm going to ask a couple more questions. But if you guys got questions, we've got 2 mics out here. Anything out there that, you know, you would find interesting to do?
Oh, anything that will have me. I really hate to be so generic, but yeah. I like to tell stories, and I would like to pay my rent doing it.
Live the dream.
I'm 100% with you on that one.
In recent years, I've been cast in more video game stuff than I ever have before in my career, and it's always a joy to give work, but video games are fascinating because you're recording so many possible outcomes, and so if you're with it, versus like doing a show where there's a straightforward, more or less linear script where there's a very clear arc for your character, in video games, if you're playing a large enough character, you get to record various options, so it's kind of like getting to see, you give more time with the characters, like, oh, what happens if they make this decision, and that's really fun. I find the process really rewarding, even though it can be very hairy sometimes because there's so many factors, and you're frequently like, you know, a script, a normal dub script, or for a whatever you want to call it, any sort of show, you get to see other people's lines, and you get kind of context for what's going on, so you're kind of reading everything that everyone else is saying too. Not so with video game scripts. Video game scripts are just your lines, and you're like, I have no idea what's going on. And luckily, a good director will be like, here's what's happening, and this is what happens if the player does this. But you're not given, you're given sometimes too much freedom because you don't have much of a reference point. They're like, yeah, just do the thing. And you're like, ah, how about this? And they're like, yeah, that's good. And you're like, was it? I have no idea.
And sometimes for that, even you'll have something like just an ellipsis.
Yeah.
And that will indicate a react.
with no, like, to what am I reacting? Or why? You really have to rely on the director. But every now and again, the skies, like, the clouds part and the sun shines down, and a director, I've been very thankful on two different projects I've been on for a few years, they will send me the scripts at least a day in advance. With everyone's lines, and mine are highlighted because I'm an actor and nobody taught us to read. It's the plight of our time and of our community. But yeah, you just, every now and again, you get that full scope and you get to use all those tools that we all learned way back in the day that are serve us really well in those other situations, because we've got just this stack of script analysis, skills, like running as a background process. But yeah, games are
It's a really fun process.
So how often do you have to do lots of
All the time.
Yeah, that was a really good hit sound. Can you do a little more?
In the old, it depends on your director, of course, but sometimes I'll just be like, you know, they'll have it written down, like, you know, here's a fight react, there's like three mediums, two hards, two, like a couple of death rattles, things like that, and it's just kind of listed out, and you're like, and you just kind of run stuff up the flagpole and see if the director, you know, goes, yeah, it works. But I had one director who would, like, he had done, it was for Smite. I've done a lot of skins in Smite. And so there's a very specific, like, sheet of reactions that go, it's like 160 of them or something like that, that are all, they want ABC takes of every single one. So, like, double everything by three, or double, I'm an actor. triple everything. And I had one director that was like, because you're kind of lost. He's like, oh, there's a little react and a big react, and then like then a big react and then a little react, and like, oh, okay. So you're like, and this director would be like, okay, you're pushing a fridge 1 foot. You're like, oh, perfect. And then he's like, cool, now you're pushing that same fridge off a cliff. It's like little like details like that. You're like, this is perfect. So whenever you're playing a game or watching a show and you see a really good react, it might look like you're throwing like a fireball punch that's like ending the day or like killing the villain. And what we were told was, you're throwing a purse. And that's what got us there. You never know.
And that's a good lesson for the directors out in the audience, those who want to direct. Give good direction. Give example. That helps out.
Exactly. You're throwing a picnic basket filled with Nerf balls. The more specific, the more fun it is.
Hello.
Dummy.
We're all family here. We all love you. It's all good.
What character do you think deserves more representation, like more screen time? Like in your personal opinion? It doesn't
matter. Aerie.
Tenya.
We're all going to say us.
Okay, let me rephrase. That's not you.
I would go with probably Kagakure. I feel like I never see her show up.
Mic drop. That's good. I can't follow that.
thank you very much. Question over here.
Okay, this one, forgive me, is not necessarily My Hero related, but it's for Mr. Tatum. Is it true that you wrote most of the dialogue for Frieza in Dragon Ball Z Kai?
Quite a bit of it, yeah. Way back in the day.
What was the inspiration? Because that was transformative.
The inspiration was the actor Chris Ayres, may he rest in peace, who was a dear friend of mine for a very long time. He's actually a big reason of why I got in the business. And when my then lead writer, head writer, John Bergmeier, who's Tien in the franchise, when Dragon Ball came back as Kai, everyone was super excited because it was like, oh, we're getting to revisit this, but now we have the technology kind of thing. And everyone was super excited, and I got to, you know, work on it, and I was like, you know, when I just heard, you know, as a writer, of course, you preview the Japanese extensively. You watch it over and over and over again to kind of get the music down and kind of hear the voice in your head. And Emily, you know, we all, several of us on this panel, write, and I think we agree that whether the actor you have in your head gets the role or not, you do usually write with someone you know in mind, just because it helps guide the process. And I just thought of Chris, because I'm like, this is Chris. And so I wrote to, in my mind, what I knew Chris's strengths as an actor to be, and he just happened to get the part, and it was great. I'll never forget it. He called me after his first session, and in his Frieza voice, he left me a voicemail, which I still have, where he was like, hello, Mr. Tatum, and I was like, ah, he got the part, I'll be damned. So so my inspiration for Frieza was, one, the original Japanese villain is so good, and that voice is so unique and so textured and wonderful, that I was like, who does that sound like to me, and who can say this dialogue, this juicy, classic, sort of, you know, over-the-top villain dialogue, and Chris was immediately the person that came to mind, and that's who I wrote to, and he got the part. Never happens in anywhere else in life does happen, but it happened, and that just happened to work out. And then, yeah, so there it is.
Thank you very much.
I was wondering, how would you suggest for people that want to get into voice acting, where can they find places to be able to audition for, like, where can you find things to audition for?
So, you've activated my trap card. So, that's a trickier question. Markets are changing, and it really depends on where your focus is. We don't talk about that a lot when we're at anime cons, because this is anime time, but most of us do kind of diversify. So you've got anime, games, you have commercial work within, even within that, there's like IVR phone systems, there's medical narration, there's audiobooks, there's corporate internal, like there are, you know, as many varieties of flowers in the land, there are things to do with your voice. So figuring out what you want to do, what your voice is suited for, then you can figure out your market. And so for things like anime, remote has opened up a little, but that window is basically shutting. So for that, you may need to actually relocate to markets where those things are produced in order to get those auditions. You also will have to sort of decide whether you want to go the route of sourcing these auditions for yourself, which may mean cold emails, which is a hard sell in today's world. But it also may mean classes where you get to meet people who are casting, showcase your talents, and also learn from them. You may choose to get demos in order, which also requires coaching. That is a big through line. Acting. Learn to act. Learn to do all of it. Every piece of acting you can. Don't just rely on sound. So you may choose to take classes, to make demos, and to submit yourself to agencies, and then you would source those auditions from agencies. There are lots of ways, if you are just looking to practice, to do that from sort of anywhere. And so you can source things like a good old casting call club. You can even just look at like open auditions or auditions open as a keyword search on Twitter, and there are a lot of independent creators who will post their casting calls that way. You are sort of looking to get started. It really just kind of depends on what you are focusing on. And then you sort of just follow the rabbit hole of research until you find what works for you. My TED talk. That was fantastic.
I will also add,
what is the strangest line that you've ever said and ever?
Ever, like in anything, ever?
Like anything that you've
the strangest ever line I've ever said is probably not a character. It's probably just me.
Favorite scene? I'll start. My favorite is when he is when Tinny is on top of the exit sign telling everyone to calm down. Because it's such a perfect little encapsulation of what he is as a character. Like even his getting there, he's like, he's imperfect but doing the right thing.
Yes.
Which is kind of his tag. And I just love he's on there and he's got it, but these massive calves are like trembling and trying to keep his balance. I'm like, this is the perfect Ida moment. And it's fun to I think it's one of my favorite moments I've ever done because it's just such a perfect little capsule of who that character is.
My favorite scene is about to release like this weekend or next week.
So watch for it.
I don't know.
My favorite scene is at the school festival when Aries on Muriel's shoulder, she smiles again. It took me so long to record that line because I was like, I mean, it wasn't a line, it was just a reaction. But it's like, okay, don't cry, don't cry. The payoff of that was really special. Hi. Who does Rico play? Lamillion? I haven't seen this show. I'm sorry. I'm required to
be here, even though it was in one episode. But my favorite scene that I've seen is Lemillion's little face poking out of the water as he spins. I keep saying that as a gif or gif, depending on who you are. And it makes me think of Rico. It's a very different, it's like very like, that's a good moment.
He is Lemillion.
He's like, 100% he is Lemillion,
A little more chaotic though. I think that his energy is a little more chaotic. Than
like if Lemillion were really into escape rooms. Like unhealthily into escape rooms.
I think for me, it was in that movie that I was in, not the second one, the first one, I don't know names, I don't know stuff, but it was one where everybody's like, it's dressed all like to go to prom and stuff, but then like, five of us get locked in the hotel, and Hagagari just like puts on a Kigu, and it's like, I brought Uno! And that's her contribution to saving the world in that film. And I loved it. I was like, yes.
Thank you very much. Over here. That's why our audience is now here. Over here.
What is the most embarrassing moment that happened in studio? I've got
that's
one.
That's none of your business.
Yeah. Okay.
It involved an onion and a cold.
A weird one. I was like such a nervous wreck for like the first 4 years that I worked. I just like was having stress dreams that like I'd show up and my key card wouldn't work anymore, and like Mike and Sabo would be on the other side, and I'm like. I had a dream where I think it was even Sabo just from through the glass said like we just thought you'd be better. I was just like stressed out all the time. He would never say that to me. Lovely.
Yeah.
At least not to my face. But I was just a nervous wreck all the time, and I remember I had worked with Bevins on a couple of things. We did Devil's a Part-Timer and Danganronpa pretty much back-to-back when we were still doing things for DVD. And I was, like, gathering up all my stuff and could only see him out of the corner of my eye, and I saw him do this. And I had never hugged Chris Bevins before, but he was very clearly gesturing for me to hug him. So I went all in there. Like, I'm a great hugger. And I gave him a little squeeze, and it looked like he was just holding the door open for me.
I love that so much, though. I love that Bevins like, oh, here, we seem to be hugging.
I said out loud to him, I see what you're doing now, but it's already begun. This is happening. So we hugged.
Oh my god, I love that. I love that. I'm gonna do that to him next time I see him. Like, come here! My embarrassing moment, I have many. I have a tendency to embarrass myself. Shocking, I know. But it's early days for me. I was still doing it just part-time on the side, meaning I came in like on the weekends and at night when you could do that. Because there was only like 10 people in the world that knew where Funimation was. And so I went in and I was auditioning for Colleen. She was doing it. It was one of the Tsubasa Chronicles arcs. And I auditioned for this character. I don't even remember the name of the character, but so there's a term that we use in the booth when you're recording to flaps or to the mouth movements. You're on the track, and sometimes when you're done with the line, if you've messed up, rather than stop, they just keep rolling, and the director will be like, hey, you know what they say is, can you give me one more wild? Wild just means you're no longer recording the animation, you're now just recording that it's still going and the animation is kind of skipped ahead and you're like whatever, and you're just doing that because there's an energy to it that the director feels rather than stop and go back. Just, hey, give me one more wild just like that. So it's frequent here. I had never heard that expression before. And I was auditioning, doing two animation. It was kind of a paid audition. This character was very light in the voice and very kind of like airy and very chill, and everything was very chill and kind of disconnected. And the line, I don't remember the line, let's say the line was like, how are you today? Or thank you very much. Let's say it was, thank you very much. And I heard Colleen go, give me one more wild. And my brain goes, all right. Thank you very much! Blew out the microphone. The engineer was like, oh my god. And I look out the window, I'm like, and she's dying laughing. She's like, no, that's not what that means. I'm like, oh, no one told me. I heard wild, and I'm like, I'm committed. I have no idea. Doesn't
you
seem to fit the animation to me, but I trust my director.
Wow.
Early days for me. Wild, and I did. I did indeed.
I actually had one that happened on Thursday. it was the end of the day, and I was leaving the office, and Justin Cook is actually my boss. And, you know, he's a great guy, like, super nice. But I was a little brain dead because it was the end of a long day, and I got into the elevator with him, and he goes, "Hey, how are you? How's it going? How are you?" And I went, "Dude!" Like, I don't know. I wanted to say, like, good, or, like, doing well, but "Dude" came out, and then I was like, "Never, my brain is dead. Never, don't look at me.
What was I thinking? Was the fight against Stain, what was I thinking?
Yes.
Oh, I was thinking, I messed up. It was hard. I was very emotional about it. And it didn't help that Stain was played by Rob McCullough, who's one of my favorite human beings on the face of the earth. And I'm like, oh, but I have to hate him. And that's hard, because it's just hard to hate Rob McCullough. There's no reason to, ever. But yeah, I also love these guys. And when I thought, they're going to die because of me, I get really emotionally attached to things. And I get swept. I think we all do, right? We get into it, and we're also fans of it. And we're like, yes, no, I know. Oh. And so all I can think about is, like, they're going to die. This show's gotten really dark, and it's my fault.
It was a pretty dramatic shift from the fun and games, like, oh,
really
I won the
was.
Tournament, hooray!
Yeah. It's like, we're all gonna die now.
Your brother's not well.
Jeez! I was just happy to be there. It's good to be included. And you look for those opportunities to grow closer to your friends and kind of bond that way. I love the Stain arc a lot, especially because it is our sort of first foray into that really dark underbelly of, like, what is a hero? What is a villain? What's the difference?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't have enough good things to say about it. That's a great moment in the show.
Yeah, such a good moment.
I always accidentally call it the Stained arc, which is
Stained.
Like the Bane.
The man.
Arc. I'm like, oh, the Stained arc.
Yeah. Well, guys, thank you very much for your questions. I'm sorry we didn't get to everybody, but they're going to be at their table at the Bank Center, so definitely go see them. Get something signed. I recommend an onion.